had to smile when I saw the title that was given to the topic. The one thing I did object to was the title that was given to me. It said Rav HaIr. But when I write the word HaIr, I write H A apostrophe I R. The way it's written, it says Rav Hair, and as you can see, I have far from Rav Hair. Okay. Elizabeth is almost unique as far as it comes to Midrash HaMakom. The only places where you have them, essentially, are one shul towns, where there's a single shul, and therefore everyone is together, and the minhagim that are fixed get fixed there. When you have multiple shuls, you tend to have multiple minhagim. There is no minhag hamakom, there's a minhag beis hakneses, but not minhag hamakom. Elizabeth was unique in that from its very beginning, there were multiple shuls with a single rav. And this goes back quite a while. The first shul that was built that I know of was Hoch Yosher in 1881. It's 135 years ago. I don't know who the first rav was. There was a rav in the early teens of the previous century, Rav Bernstein, who made aliyah and set a trend, by the way, which is almost become a minhag hamakom for Elizabeth, of having a lot of olim. Because I think that on a per capita basis, there are, I don't know of any community which can boast a higher percentage of people who have made aliyah than our community has. After that, there was Rav Kanvitz, one of the more famed rabbonim. And since 1918, it's been a family business as far as I'm concerned. My grandfather's a Kanvitz, and my mother's father became Rav in 1918, followed by my father, and that's where we are today. There was a year and a quarter when there was no rav between my grandfather's passing and my father's marrying my mother, in which they waited for the rav's oldest daughter to marry a rav to take his place. He had requested that if she does, they take him as his mamalei makom. It was one of the few things in matters of Yiddishkeit that they listened to him. Okay, now, when it comes to minhagei hamakom, it has a high standing in din that one should have a specific minhag. In fact, it's a mitzvah deraisa in a sense, because it says, "Lo tisko dedu." Lo tisko dedu, in its literal sense, is talking about cutting one's flesh in the morning. But we also darshan it, "Lo sasu lechem agudos agudas." Don't form disparate groups in the same place. There is a situation which is known as Shnei Bote Din Ba'ir, where there are two separate communities, as happened in the times of Beshan and Besilo, for instance. But essentially, it should be one minhag. And it reflects itself in one of the most customs which is most violated. Din says that Achol HaMayit, either everybody wears tefillin or nobody wears tefillin. Walk into any shul in town and you will see that that minhag is not observed. The minhag in Lita, where most of the minhagim of this community came from, because most of the early settlers were Lithuanian Jews, is to wear tefillin on Chol HaMoed. To wear it, and in fact, to make a bracha. Well, my father changed our minhag some 50 years ago and told me to start making a bracha on Chol HaMoed, just put on without a bracha. He didn't explain to me why, and I never got to ask him. That minhag is reflected in one of the minhagim that we do have, and that is that on Chol HaMoed, the Baal Tefillah, the chazan, must be somebody wearing tefillin. Because since the minhag hamakom is to wear tefillin, we don't say anything to the ones who don't wear tefillin. I remember when I learned in Tells, which is, I shudder to think about it, I got to Tells 66 years ago. But it's ancient history. I was never there Chol HaMoed because it was always Ben Hazmani. But the Rosh Yeshiva mentioned that the bacher was there who did not wear tefillin, either could not daven in the Beis Medrash, or was told to put on tefillin without a bracha. That's how careful they were as far as the minhagim were concerned. I'm not going to discuss that particular minhag, but as I say, it reflects itself in that part of it, that we don't let the Baal Shachris daven for the Yamid unless he is wearing tefillin. And I might mention just parenthetically, although it's not so much related to minhag hamakom, that there is a difference between wearing tefillin on Rosh Chodesh and wearing tefillin on Chol HaMoed when it comes to taking them off. for Rosh Chodesh, we keep the tefillin on until after Kriyas HaTorah and take them off right before Musaf. Chochamayit, the custom is to take them off during Chazor HaShachar, right after Kedusha of Shachris, during Chazor HaShachar of Shachris. Because when we say Halal on Rosh Chodesh, it's a Halal of a minig, it's not a yontif, but Halal on Rosh on Chochamayit Pesach and Chochamayit Sukkos is because of yontif. That's the moed part of the Chochamayit. There's a difference between the two. Sukkos is obligatory and Pesach is only done because of minag, for reasons that you will learn in Gemara if you get to it. If you learn Daf Yomi, you certainly will. Mainly because Sukkos each day has a different korban and therefore each day is considered a separate yontif. Whereas Pesach, all 7 days min HaTorah and therefore all 8 days here, are the same korban, hence one yontif, and therefore it's only on the first day of the yontif that you put on, you say Halal Shalei, you get Halal said the rest of the time. So that's also one that I mentioned, that not because it's a minhag here, as far as taking off the tefillin, but because that's what the din says, which one should do. Okay, now, most of the minhagim revolve around the shul. They deal with davening, they deal with Kriyas HaTorah. So let me take care of one which is not. It is not the minhag of Elizabeth to use bananas for carpets. It's not the minhag of the city. That's our family minhag. My grandfather's kind of brother started it. As I told many people, the reason he did it was to be able to teach halacha. People were under the impression that bananas are fruit, and therefore the brothers were bar priyates. If bananas were bar priyates, you would never be able to eat bananas. Because the banana produces fruit for 4 years, and then you can't use it anymore. And the first 3 years that a tree's life, any fruit that it produces, not only may not be eaten, you may not have any benefit from it. So it would be orla. The only time they would eat bananas would be in the fourth year. Dr. Cook, Sifan Rocha, used that as proof of the fact that the bracha must be Adama. Yes, we don't find any prohibited fruits. And the banana would be, especially as a show, we had that the Ravai as well, where the fourth year also has a special din, you'd have fruits that can't be eaten. So he would mention it when he would learn the Hilchos Pesach and say, come to Karpas, and saying, for Karpas, you can use any Adama. You can use lettuce, more should not be used. But you can use celery, you can use potatoes. Where parsley came from, I don't know. But he said, yeah, you can use bananas. And he said, bananas, that's a fruit. He said, no, bananas are adama. That's how it started. Somehow or other, that became a well-known minhag of Elizabeth, which it isn't. So you are not violating any minhag hamakom by using your potato or whatever else it is used for karpas. Another non-shul related minhag is one we are just finishing now, as when to observe the prohibitions of Sphira. We know that there are 33 days between Pesach and Sukkos, between Pesach and Shavuos, when weddings are prohibited and haircuts and shaving are prohibited. Perhaps I shouldn't say shaving because Mutash Shogi Vadi Vizid. Although someone once said he had a heter for shaving. He says, if he doesn't shave, he'll lose his job. He loses his job, he won't be able to support his family. And the din is that if you have hairs, which are ma'ake v'sarachila, which prevent you from eating, you're allowed to shave them on. Okay. There are several different minhagim. As far as the haircuts are concerned, many Sfaradim do it for all 49 days. They just don't take haircuts or Sfira at all. Those who do, so there are 33 days. And it's because of the Talmidim of Rabbi Akiva who died out during the period between Pesach and Shavuos, which was a devastating spiritual loss. It almost wiped out the knowledge of Torah. So the question is, when did they die? We know that on Lag BaOmer, apparently they didn't. That's why Lag BaOmer became a holiday in the middle of Sphira, a break. Not according to everybody. According to the Mechaber, according to the Sesef, you're not allowed to take the haircut until the morning of the 34th. In other words, you have to have 33 full days plus. But for most Ashkenazim, Lag BaOmer is a day in which you're permitted. So some practice the first 33 days, which means beginning with Pesach and ending on Lag BaOmer. while others have the final 33 days, which is essentially from Rosh Chodesh Iyar until Shavuos. It should be pointed out also that there are 33 days. So if you those who practice the first 33 days, which would be until Lag BaOmer, you need the Lag BaOmer day itself also as the 33rd day. But we have a din of Miktsas HaYom Kekula. When it comes to Avelus, such as Rahman Goslam, when a person is sitting Shiva, once the morning of the seventh day comes, the Shiva ends. So here too, once the morning of the 33rd day comes, it is permitted to take haircuts. For those who practice the last 33 days, there are two versions of that. One starts from the first day of Rosh Chodesh, the year, which is the 30th day of Sivan, plus 29 days in Iyar, which is 30, plus the first 3 days of Sivan is 33, but again, the third one, which is today. Again, we say Mitzvah Yom Kekulo, so not take a haircut last night, but could take one this morning. And the other version of it is, you can do what you want on Rosh Chodesh, but then you have to wait until Erev Shavuos to take a haircut. And if you lose the 2 days of Erev Chodesh, you gain the last 2 days of the Shavuos and the Akbalah. On that, there is no real ironclad minhag in Elizabeth. I mean, there have been years when we've had weddings on Rosh Chodesh year. We've had years in which we started from Rosh Chodesh and took haircuts. And as far as I'm aware, we're always taken starting with the Shavuos and the Akbalah, starting with the 2 days before Shavuos, the equivalent of today. But the minhag there again, this is a minhag year, which means that if you live in town, you do not have the option of deciding to keep the first 33 days. You must keep the last 33 days. You keep the first 33 days also. Mm-hmm. The Sfardim certainly don't violate anything by keeping all 49. But it is prohibited for a person who lives in town to take a haircut after Lag BaOmer until Shlosh Tzimei HaGbalah. That's what we talk about. Minhag HaOmer as being binding. That's a case in point. This is very rough. If you ask me, I would rather have the first 33 days. Because you can't do these things during Chol HaMoed anyway. So already you have 7 days that you can't do it, and then it's only 26 more. Whereas Hamidic, you have all of Yom Tov that you can't take a haircut, shave, and then you have 33 days after that. But that's the way the custom was, and convenience or not, convenience does not usually enter into choice of minhag. I'll get rid of the rest of the ones that are not related to davening. They're very brief. And there must be more that I'm not thinking of. I did this when I was sitting in Eretz Yisrael 2 winters ago, and I put down what I remembered, and every now and then, as the time passed, I reminded myself of something or other. Something came up in davening that I said, oh yeah, we have a meeting on that too, and put it in. There are probably some others I'll come across yet too, and they'll be added to it. Our meeting as far as the fasts are concerned, when to begin and when to end. Now here, this is something my father instituted, and that is that on Yom Kippur, we wait 54 minutes at the end before we eat. This is beyond what we do on Shabbos, as far as Shabbos is concerned, where we wait, and that has changed also. I don't think astronomy has changed, I think the level of Funkite has changed. Mm-hmm. But once upon a time, we used to wait 36 minutes for Mitzvah Shabbos. And now we wait 45 minutes in 9 months of the year, and in May, June, and July, we wait 50 minutes. But as far as the fasts are concerned, other than Yom Kippur, we wait 42 minutes. And as far as the beginning of the fast is concerned, again, other than Tisha B'Av and Yom Kippur, we start at 72 minutes before sunrise. Even though, according to the Meluchos, Amud HaShachar, dawn or daybreak is a little earlier than that, but nonetheless, this is the way the meaning developed, that we wait 72 minutes beforehand to start the fast. I always suspect that my father wanted to wait 54 minutes for Yom Kippur because he used to dive in Nila. Mm-hmm. It was quite an experience to hear his Nila. If anybody's experienced it, they know what I mean. And he always ran out of time. This way he had another couple of minutes to do it. I always suspect that for that. Another minute is as far as the time of Kiddush Levana. Kiddush Levana is a bracha we make basically in thanks for the benefit we get from moonlight. And it's said whenever there's a new moon. So the din says The Iker Hadin, you can't say it until 3 days, which means 72 hours after the Mulah. And you can say it until half the month. Between one Mulah and the next is 29 days, 12 hours, and 44 minutes, plus 3 1/3 seconds. That's a chelek, one chelek. And half of that is about 14 3/4 days. But, again, here we follow the Beis Yosef, and we begin. We don't start say Kiddush Levana until the 7th day of the month, regardless of when the Mulah was. So on Zion, the night of Zion, is the first time we say Kiddush Levana. And we end it on the night of the 15th, even if it's past half the month. You go from, in other words, you have 8 days to do it, from Zion through Tesvot, that it can be done. Normally one does it, the reason it's done on Tzadei Shabbos, again, that's not a minhag hamakom, it's a general minhag, is because it should be done with simcha, which you know you're dressed up, and Shabbos you are, so on Tzadei Shabbos you got to show and you do it. In Yerushalayim, in the Shalai Davin, although very few people listen to it, there's a sign that's up every Tisha B'Av that according to the girl, you do it on the third night, you do it on the 3 days after the mother, no matter what, as soon as you can. But most people wait until after the 9 days because, again, they're not days of happiness. So there's a sign in the shul every Tisha B'Av that, as is the old Min of Yerushalayim, we will have Kiddush Levana an hour after the fast so people can go home and put on their shoes and be dressed properly for it. That's why it was done with Shabbos, generally speaking. On Yom Kippur, again, according to the Grod there, you certainly should do it earlier, so you have the schus of one more mitzvah before Yom Kippur. Nonetheless, the minute was because of the fact that people should be distraught about the impending Yom Hadin. We therefore wait until after Yom Kippur to say it. And that is our basic minute. There, if a person wants to say Kiddush Levana on his own, he can do it, but the shuls will not say it until Metzoy Tisha B'Av and Metzoy Yom Kippur. And there are other two minor things. There's a whole question on Metzoy Shabbos of Hanukkah. What comes first? Hanukkah candles or Havdol? And it's a big machlokas. You say Todi Rishayno Todi Todi Kodam. So then the more frequent one is Havdol, obviously. Havdol comes every Metzoy Shabbos. Hanukkah candles only come 8 nights a year. On the other hand, there's the question of Pirsum Anisa, which would give priority to the Hanukkah candles. So the custom is split, and this is mentioned in halacha. In shul, Chanukah candles first, Havdalah second. At home, Havdalah first, and Chanukah candles second. Of course, here, if a person has a different minhag, no one's going to know that. It's done in the privacy of your home, but in terms of what the minhag hamakom is, that is our minhag. And another question of minhag, Rachmanah Litzlan, when there's a death. So the din is that the Yovel on the first day does not put on tefillin. The question is, what constitutes the first day? Is it the Yom HaMisa, the day in which the death took place, or Yom HaKfura, the day of burial? Of course, if burial takes place on the same day, there's no problem. But as happens most often, unfortunately, in our society, where you can't arrange things that quickly, and generally speaking, if a person passes away on a Tuesday, the funeral's going to be on a Wednesday. So until the funeral, there's no question about not putting on tefillin. You're not allowed to put on tefillin because now you're not allowed to make a bracha. It's known on this potter mikvah mitzvah, and it says no brachas. But what happens in that case if the funeral ends when it's still daylight and there's still time enough to put on tefillin? Does one put it on or not? So it's a big machlokas indeed, whether we follow the Yom HaKfura, which says don't do it, or the Yom HaMisa, which says that today was not the Yom HaMisa, therefore you can't do it. And the meaning I'm welcome here is to put it on. And I found out that in Yerushalayim that was the minhag also. Because I had that shaila, and I went to my mother's funeral. She passed away Friday night, and the levaya was Monday. And I asked the shaila, we have milk in the house, do I put on tefillin? They looked at me and said, of course. That was the end of the argument. Okay. So those are the ones which don't deal with davening or with laity. Now let's start talking about the Kriyas HaTorah. There are some interesting things here. First of all, the question about keeping the safety door open or closed. You know, Schwartz will tell you that I told him at least two times, not three, when he came in for his brother, that that's our meeting. This, too, is a question. It's a question of the Gemara, it's not Rikus. And one day, is, one opinion is that you do close it, one opinion is that you don't. And the psak is, you don't. And yet we do. The Mishnah Berurah explains that the ones who do close it, is, they learn the machlokas, not should you leave it open or should you leave it closed. Are you required to close it or may you leave it open? And the psak halach is you may leave it open. But the preferred way is to close it. The reason is so that one not get the mistaken impression that you're reading the brachas from the Sefer Torah, as though the brachas were written in the Sefer Torah. And those whose meaning is to leave it open, either shut their eyes or turn their face, they avert their faces. Which always struck me as being odd. It's as though you don't want to look in the Sefer Torah. Mm-hmm. You're turning your face from it. Here the meaning is that it is definitely closed, and you must close it. And that's the basis for it. Now, the stops for the various aliyos do not have any particular kedusha. I don't think anybody knows who chose where to stop. There are rules as to where you stop. This is mentioned in halacha. For instance, the Torah is written in paragraphs, parshios. Parsha being where it's one block of writing. Without a gap. There are two kinds of gaps. One is a gap where a whole line is left blank, and one is a gap in the same line. The beginning of the line, a gap, and then the end of the line. One is called a parsha psucha, an open parsha, and the other is called a parsha stuma, a closed parsha. One may not begin nor end within three psukim of a start or an end of a parsha, unless the whole parsha is less than three psukim. But otherwise, you can't do that. This causes all kinds of interesting problems when it comes to Rosh Chodesh, for instance. You have four aliyahs and 15 psukim. So it would seem there's no problem. Four times three is 12, and it's 15. The problem is that the paragraphs are 8, 2, and 5. And you try to divide that into four. The 8 can only give you two aliyahs, because you don't have 9 psukim. The 2 can't give you an aliyah, because it's only 2 psukim, and there's a minimum of 3 psukim. The 5 can only give you 1, because you can't, it's less than 6. So the most you can get, if you were just to read straight through, would be 3 aliyahs. And therefore, it requires repeating. So, on this there are 2 minhagim. The almost universal minhag is to read the first 3, and then repeat the 3rd, 4th, and say the 4th and the 5th, and then read the 6th, 7th, and 8th, plus the 2 psukim of Gemara Shabbos, and the 4th aliyah is Rosh Chodesh. This technically is wrong, because the 2nd aliyah begins 2 psukim into the parsha, not 3. And how one gets around that, it is not explained. The reason for doing that, by the way, is not to stop within 2 psukim, not to start within 2 psukim or end within 2 psukim, is because a person who comes in late and sees you starting from the 3rd pasuk may think that the previous person only laid the first 2 psukim. When we stop 2 psukim from the end, and a person has to leave, he may think that the next person is only going to lay in 2 psukim. So I guess we take it for granted that since Rosh Chodesh is one which comes month in and month out, everybody has learned that we didn't lay just 2 psukim, we lay in 3. In some places, the Gaon's minhag, the first aliyah is the same every place, it's 3 psukim. The 3rd aliyah is always the last 3 psukim of the first parsha plus the 2 psukim of Shabbos. And the 4th aliyah is always the same, the Rosh Chodesh aliyah, 5 psukim. The question is the 2nd aliyah, where we, for the 2nd aliyah, read psukim 3, 4, and 5. The Gaon has you reading 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And then you have to repeat not one plus, you have to repeat 3 psukim, because you have to start with 6, 7, 8, plus the 2 for Shabbos for the Shlishi. Okay. There is a minhag that we have, and it's a fairly prevalent minhag, which, strictly speaking, is Shalokadi. What happens when you have a special occasion which coincides with Rosh Chodesh? Say, Parsha Shkolim comes out on Rosh Chodesh. In all those special parshios, the Haftorah is not the Haftorah of Rosh Chodesh, it's the Haftorah of the special event. And on Hanukkah, you can have 3 coming together. in fact, you can have that for you can have Rosh Chodesh, and you can start. You can have Rosh Chodesh and Hanukkah, and the Shabbos. So you have two special occasions coincide. Those are the occasions. Those are the occasions we think are three secret Torah. Three secret Torah are taken out. Possibly, there are four different times in a year when three secret Torah are taken out. One is every year, and that's Simchas Torah. One is when Shabbos Chanukah is Rosh Chodesh. One is when Parshas Shkolim is Rosh Chodesh, and one is Parshas Achodesh is Rosh Chodesh. You can't have all of them in the same year, because Parshas Shkolim and Parshas Achodesh have to be a day apart. They're two consecutive months, and they can't both be on Shabbos. That can't happen. So there, the custom is that we read the Haftarah of the special Parsha, but we read the first and last psukim of the Haftarah of the Rosh Chodesh. Not quite. The first and the next last, because on Rosh Chodesh itself, we read the Haftarah, and then we repeat the next to last pasuk, because the last pasuk doesn't then put above the cases for Eretz Cherem. It's not such a nice ending, so we read the V'ayamid Echodesh V'chodesh again. We read them, the first and last pasukim, after the Haftarah. When it's Shabbos, Rosh Chodesh, Hanukkah, it's always, inevitably, also Erev Rosh Chodesh. It's the only time Shabbos, that Rosh Chodesh Teves will be Shabbos, is if it's Shabbos Sunday. Otherwise, you get messed up as far as when Pesach can come out. So then we do more than that. We read the Haftarah of Shabbos Chanukah, Roni Simchi, plus the first and last Pesukim of Rosh Chodesh, plus the first and last Pesukim of Mochar Chodesh. I say this in Shloka Din, because in Yirtzeh Hashem, b'mehera b'yameinu, we will not be able to do it. If we get to the point where we do the Haftarah as they were meant to be done, which means not from a Chumash, but from a Klaf, you're not allowed to do that. You can't go from one, you cannot lay from one Sefer to another. And therefore, since the Haftarah of Rosh Chodesh is Rosh Chanukah, Rosh Simchi, is what's Hashem, and Rosh Chari. And Rosh Chodesh is Yishayahu, and Mochar Chodesh is in Shmuel. So therefore, you will not be able to do those extras. Likewise, there's another place where we read three pieces for the Haftarah, where we, again, the Minhag HaMakom is Shelo Kedin, and that is Shabbos Shuvah. Shabbos Shuvah, we read three pieces. We read Shuvah Yisrael, Hashem Nosan Kolo Lifnei Chelo, and Nikel Kamocha. Now, they're for three separate Sfarim, but they're all Treyosar. And Treyosar is considered one Sefer for this purpose. But the din is you can jump forward, you can't jump backward. Yet the order in which we read them is 1-3-2 instead of 1-2-3. But that was the accepted minhag in most of Lithuania. Art scroll to the contrary. In general, art scroll does things which do not follow. First, we have to understand that the editors of art scroll are not in the Sosfarit. And there's a part of the Sosfarit put into it which doesn't belong. Just as one classic example, which I get very upset about. Rosh Chodesh, I'm sorry, I'm Musaf of the Yontif. We say, Elokeinu Elokei Aviseinu, Melech Rachman Rachem Aleinu. Some Musaf Sfarad says, when it's Shabbos, Ritzeivim Nuchaseinu. The Levush, who happens to be the Pesach for Ashkenaz, says not to say it. Hartzfeld says to say it. That's the Musaf Sfarad creeping into the Musaf Ashkenaz. Another thing, in Musaf Ashkenaz, the way it was, on Shabbos morning, they say Pesukah Zimra, and they say the Hal Hagodol Kilo Amchastos, which is followed by Ranan Tzadikim. The Chazan, the Kol, and the Chazan would say the pasuk Ranan Tzadikim Hashem together with it, and start and then continue after the Chazan said Ranan Tzadikim, then they continue from there. The Chosfar apparently doesn't do it, and therefore Ashkol doesn't show it in their printing. Another thing too, in Nusach Ashkenaz, and this is a fairly recent origin, because the whole custom of saying it is a fairly recent origin. Kabbalah Shabbos is something new. It's only a few hundred years old. It's interesting how the Chadodi, which was written about 400 years ago, has become accepted in all Kehillos. There isn't Ashkenaz. Five, everyone says it. The minig was to say Mizmar Shir and Hashem Molach together. The Chazan didn't interrupt in the middle and start and end of the Levar Losabah. That came from Nusuk Sfar. Not from the Sfardim, but Nusuk Sfar. That they're said separately. But until about 30, 35 years ago, it was always said together here too. And took away a piece of Chazanus, or the Levar Losabah, and that overrode minig. Hamalach overrode everything. The original minig was to say it together. Another thing, and this will lead us to a general rule. The minig is saying, we say Magen Avos, Friday night. By right, Magen Avos was meant to be said by the Chazan only, just as he's the only one who says the Bracha, the Lekhenu Ke'avoseinu, he's the only one who says Magen Avos. But it became the custom for everybody to say it. The Mishnah Berurah mentions that the Chazan should start say the whole thing out loud. That was not the minig. The minig was everybody said Morgan Avos, and the Chazan started Kela Hodos, and that was it. Now, there are certain other things that we do also, jumping into the Tfilos. Answering Amen to the Bracha B'Bocher B'Amo Yisrael B'Ahava. Okay, there's a question. That Bracha B'Bocher B'Amo Yisrael B'Ahava, is that just one of the Birchos Krishna that's part of that, or is it also considered a Bracha on the Mitzvah of Kriya Shema? If it's a mitzvah, the bracha of Kriya Shema, you should not interrupt between it and the Shema. And therefore, you should not answer Amen. If, on the other hand, it is not, then you should answer Amen. We have the same situation about whether or not to answer Amen at Goal Yisrael. You answer Amen because it's a bracha that's being said, but you're supposed to be, have Geula, Masmich Geula B'Tfila. There should be no interruption between the Geula of Goal Yisrael and the Tfila Shema Nesra. So, do you answer Amen or don't you? So we split the difference. When it comes to Goal Yisrael, we just had it not said out loud. And that is the minhag. Chazanim should know not to say the words Goal Yisrael out loud. And that way the question never comes up. In fact, when a Chazan does say it out loud, I'm tempted to answer Amen loudly. Because you put me into a something, am I supposed to say it or not? I have managed, so far I've managed to withstand the temptation. For Shmanez, for Kriya Shema, on the other hand, the accepted psak of Nusach Ashkenaz, at least, was like the Ramah, who says explicitly, you should answer Amen. In the yeshivas I learned in, Amen was answered. In Rabban, where the Chavetz Chaim was the, I can't call him the Rosh Yeshiva, he did not have that official position. The official Rosh Yeshiva was Natali Trup. He just happened to be the one who ran the yeshiva in the Chavetz Chaim. In fact, there's a famous story told that the Chavetz Chaim and Rav Natali were discussing yeshiva matters, and a bocher came in to ask a shayla in Or HaChaim. And he went to the Chavetz Chaim. The Chavetz Chaim said, ask the Rosh Yeshiva. And Rav Natali said, of course, ask me. Bring the Rosh Yeshiva, we'll see what the din is. In any event, the Mishnah Berurah tries whenever it's possible to be yotzei l'chol hadeos. To do in a manner that you can do both. And therefore he says, say it together with the chazan, then you have no problem. Because the din is that when you finish a bracha together with the chazan, you're not allowed to answer on it. If you finish a different bracha, if you're up to Yotzei Amoros, and the Chazan saying, Baruch Amoros for Baba, you can answer Amen to his bracha, even though it's right after your bracha, because it's not only to your own bracha. And Ashkenazim only answer Amen to their own bracha. So far can do it. There's a series of brachas. The last one in the series, we do that only once in benching. And we only do that to differentiate between those brachas which are in HaTorah and the one which is in Midrabah. Okay. So the Mishnah Berurah says, say it together with the Chazan. I remember discussing it in the other show once. Because it bothers me when people say it out loud. You want to say it together with the Chazan, fine. Say it silently. But don't flaunt that you're doing it. You have to show your frum, you're knowledgeable, you know what's what. Say it silently. My point that I said, I realize that the Chazan says, the Mishnah Berurah paskens, that you should say it together with the Chazan. But you should know that the minimalism was established before the Chazan wrote that. In 1881, it hadn't been written yet. And I can tell you that in Rabban, they answered Amen to Abba Rabba Yisrael Rabba. Just as in Rabban, they said, Yiskadal v'yiskadash, and Yiskadal v'yiskadesh. And that's another story. And then I didn't put it down in the Midrash because we gave up that battle long ago. The Vilna Gaon says, you should say Yiskadal v'yiskadesh. It's something that it's very difficult to understand. He says because the verbs are Hebrew. And the Pasuk says, v'yiskadal, it doesn't say, it says, v'yiskadilti v'yiskadishti, with chirix, not with tzer. And Yisgadal is not necessarily Aramaic, it can be Hebrew too. In fact, in Aramaic you say Yisrabei, not Yisgadal. Okay. I remember hearing somebody say, I'm going to start saying Yisgadal, starting from Pashas Veschanim. Again, for some reason, I don't understand why, the Mishnah Berurah brings this down. This is not the only change that the Gaon made in the Kaddish. There's another one which is of more import, and that is to say Kirusei instead of Hirusei. Because Yisgadal and Yisgadel doesn't change the meaning, they both mean the same. The difference between Hirusei and Kirusei is what does it modify? We start out saying Yisgadal, Yisgadash, Merabor, Yisgadesh, Merabor, as the case may be, Dol Madivra, Hirusei. Instead of Hirusei, it means in the world which he created according to his will. The guy says that's not the meaning of it. It's Hashem's name should be magnified and sanctified as is his will. So the Kirusei does not refer to the immediate Bo'ma Divra. Hashem's name should be magnified and sanctified in the world that he created as is his will. So it's Kirusei. And he brings a strong riot. We say when we take out the Sefer Torah, Bo'ma Shev Baruch, Olam HaZev, Olam HaBo, Kirtzono V'Kirtzon Yireyah. Hashem did not create the world as is the desire of those who fear him. His name should be magnified as is his desire and as is the desire of those who fear him. So, in any event, so that general principle that even though Mishnah Berurah says certain things, we don't necessarily follow them, as is the case with the Magen Avos, is because again, Aramaic was formed before the Mishnah Berurah wrote that. And what the Mishnah Berurah writes is not according to all opinions, and we follow that. For some reason, saying Yisgadel instead of Yisgadal does not fit all opinions. So why the Mishnah Berurah picked that particular one to say it, I don't know. He didn't say to say Kirusei. The Goyim doesn't say the Yishalom in the second paragraph. He only has seven words of praise, and we have eight with the Yishalom. Yisadar b'Yishaleh, and that's all. So I don't know why he picked that one. But in any event, as I say, in Radin itself, they said Yisgadal. When I was in Yeshivas, nobody said Yisgadal. Literally, nobody. In the Groshu in Yerushalayim, they said Yisgadal, not Yisgadal. About 50 years ago, it became the Frumkeit of the day, so to speak, to say Yisgadal. And again, that's what's done. But preferably, the minhag should be Yisgadal, which is what most Kehilos say. Sfaradim all say Yisgadal, and most Ashkenazim said Yisgadal, and most nine Yeshivot say Yisgadal also. It's almost an act of showing off that you know what's what when you say Yisgadal. Okay. So we're talking about davening. Let's see what else there is there. We start out after Baruch Hu with Yetzirah V'Rechash V'Sesh Amorei Sakol. On Rosh Hashanah, we also say Or Olam V'Tzar Chaim Or Rosh Hashanah V'Mar Yehi, and we add things. So the Mishnah Berurah says, apparently some people, since the Chazan gurgles it, sings it, they would listen and not say it. And he says, be sure that yes, you say it on Rosh Hashanah. He didn't say that about Shabbos. Because on Shabbos it was never said out loud to begin with. So there was no room for mistake. And again, this is something that I think came through Musach Ashkenaz from Nusach Sfarad. I think in Nusach Sfarad, when I say Nusach Sfarad, you understand I'm not talking about a Sfaradi. In Nusach Sfarad, I think the Chazan says it out loud. Aramaic is not to say it out loud. And therefore it was not necessary for the Chafetz Chaim to warn you about the consequences of it. Talking about Kaddish. Kaddish is said when you end something. When you end learning, we say Rabbanan Kaddish. When we end Sukkot Yizro, we say Rabbanan Kaddish. When we end the Shemona Esrei, we say Kaddish Shalom. And when we end the davening, we say what's called Kaddish Shalom B'litit Kaddish. We discuss. I'm going to speak Ashkenaz. Just Ashkenaz. A few hundred years ago, there's a Medrash purported to be attributed to Rabbi Akiva, different versions of it, that it's a schus for the departed if his son gets a kohol to respond, say Heshmei Rabba, say Baruch Hashem Avodah. And therefore, it became the minhag that an oval for a parent serves as the baal tefillah, davens for the yom. But not everybody can daven for the yom. There's only one baal tefillah per tefillah. And there are some who can't daven for the yom. And primarily, there were children. And before the age of bar mitzvah, who lost parents. And they couldn't daven for the yom, because they couldn't be mitzvah people. So they were the ones who would say Kaddish. In fact, I read an old sitter, some 500 years old, it says, Hayela Domer Kaddish. Because that's what we're saying. But then the problem became, now, so the number of Kaddishim is few. There was no Kaddish after Yismar Shikha, because Yismar Shikha, it wasn't said until the time of the Arizal, approximately. There were no Kaddishim said after the various Mizmorim that are said at the end of davening. Just when we finished davening, at the end of davening, a Kaddish was said. That, by the way, reflects itself in another part of Minhag HaMakom. This goes against the Rambam, more or less. Rambam says to say a Kaddish after Oleinu. And if there is no Yasam, we don't just walk out without a Kaddish. Somebody should say Kaddish. By right, even if everybody has a parent, the Chazan should say Kaddish. But because it's a bad simon and most parents would object, we don't do that. But that's supposed to be a kaddish at the end of davening. In the Ramos time, the Shushal Yom was not yet a fixed part of davening. It was a minute to start saying it. Now that it is, that last kaddish that should be said is not after Olenu, but after the Shushal Yom. And that's how we do it here. When there is no other, we don't say a kaddish after Olenu, we say it after the Shushal Yom. Again, Art Scroll does not realize that. So, but again, and the one who says Kaddish is a Shliach Tzibur, basically. And it makes as much sense for two people to say Kaddish together as it does for two people to say Chazar Sashatz together. However, since there are many times more Avelim than there are Kaddishim, so you have something called Darkei Hashal, to preserve the peace. And preserving the peace goes a long way. You can sometimes override a din. One example is one of the Minhag HaMakom. Al Pi Din, there are all kinds of priorities when it comes to getting the oven. An oval gets it. A shloshim has priority over an ordinary oval. And a shiva has priority over a shloshim. How about the yartzeit? The yartzeit is also a chiyuv. And if there's no other chiyuv, the yartzeit says it. And the yartzeit has priority over an ordinary oval. Strictly speaking, the yartzeit does not have priority over shloshim. Nonetheless, this is again the Darkei Hashalom. Our custom is to let the yartzeit have it, because the shloshim will be in shloshim tomorrow too, and the yartzeit won't be yartzeit again until the next year, whatever it may be. But that's the shloshim, and the din is his last day, and for the last 30 days, the yartzeit comes once a year. So it comes to davening for the omen, for instance, we give the yartzeit priority. But nonetheless, kaddish should be said by one person only. So what they did was to add kaddishim. So they added Kaddish after Mizmor Shikha Nasvayis Adavid, for which there is no reason. They added Kaddish after Oleinu and after Shushal Yom, and we said Adavid Ari, another one after Adavid Ari, and then after Shchedish, another one after Baruch Hinashi. And sometimes they'll still want it enough. So they agreed, all right, so let multiple people say Kaddish. However, it's only valid if it's said as though it were one person, which means it should be said together, word for word, not one running fast and one running slow. And that is the minhag, that is the halacha. But it's sometimes more practiced in the breach than in the observance. And there, the fault is considered to be the one who's going more slowly. It says if two people are saying it at a different place, answer to the first one. Of course, some people say it so fast, you really can't blame the second person for falling behind, but nonetheless, okay. Now, again, minhag halacha. Since all are supposed to say it as one, they should be saying the same nusach. So the iskadani iskadel, forget it, can't find that. But when it comes to saying that's not korkone b'korei b'shichei, that in the Ashkenazi minyan, the person who does nusach is not allowed to say it. And he's saying Kaddish by himself, he shouldn't say this is not Minhag HaMakom, but at least it's not interfering with the others. It's not making separate Kaddish at the same time. More than one person is saying Kaddish, the Asma Proclaim Kodem Sheikh should not be said. On the contrary, on the other hand, the person davens in here during the week, say, anytime, and is saying Kaddish, should say, because that's the meaning of this respect. I know when I daven here, I say the Asma Proclaim Kodem Sheikh. I also daven here, I have after Aliyah, I make the Brahman of Asfardi, because that is the meaning of Allah. Do not insist that those who speak Abras are did make the brachas of Abras Shnazit because they don't break their teeth. It's a lot easier to go from Ashkenazit to Sfaradit to Sfaradit to Ashkenazit. Because Sfaradit removes sounds, and Ashkenazit adds sounds, and it's a lot easier to remove them than to add. Just imagine. Sfaradit, Ashkenazi, goes to a Sfaradit means, so if it's a tough for herself, he says to. You can imagine a Sfaradit going to an Ashkenazi and have to start with the side English every time it comes to blood. Is this T or is it S? And whoever finished, we let that go. Okay. We do have a Minhag HaMakom, which is not quite unique to Elizabeth, but it's not too frequently practiced. And that is that when there, now, when one Kaddish at the time was said, and there was a Yahrzeit, then was he got all the Kaddish in that day. No other Obel could say Kaddish, unless it was another Yahrzeit. So that we don't have that. But it's reflected in that we give the Yahrzeit a Kaddish to himself. So where there's a Yahrzeit, we have a patch Yahrzeit. So in Shachar, it's just no problem. You do it after all, right? And then you have the Shiv Shiv, at least the Ashkenazi. Then you have the Shiv Shiv Yom afterwards. It's fine that they don't say Kaddish after all, anyway, at any time. But for Minhag HaMakom, where there's only the one Kaddish schedule, so that's where the custom was to say another capital of Tehillim. We patch Yahrzeit, only the Yahrzeit or Yahrzeit to say the Kaddish. And then, you know that the other ones not feel cheated, or they shouldn't, because we didn't. They're not mechuyev to say it every time, if the halacha says they shouldn't. So we may add another capital of tefillin to say another Kaddish for everyone. We do allow, however, together with the Yahrzeit, since my writer Shleshim has a priority over the Yahrzeit, so we allow the Shleshim to say the Kaddish together with the Yahrzeit. That's Yahrzeit for a parent. There is no such thing as saying Yahrzeit for a non-parent. There's no such obligation. It's done, you do it, you hire your Kaddish. But the actual obligation, as we said, the whole reason is that it's a schus for the child, for the parent, that the child is has the oil of answering Yeshnei Rabbah and everything else that's answered. And therefore, if a Yahrzeit for a non-parent has no priority over everybody, we don't patch Yahrzeit, you shouldn't say it together with the Yahrzeit. It's just an ordinary Kaddish as far as that goes. Before we daven Shmoneh Esrei, we say Pasuk Hashem Sosai Tiftov Priyagi Tivosai. In Mincha, we say two psukim, although it's a question, that's not mentioned. Hashem Sosai Tiftov is mentioned, and in fact it's considered the beginning of Shmoneh Esrei. Kishem Hashem Ekra is not part of Shmoneh Esrei. And at the end, we say Yivu L'Rat Sonim Retfi. Now, most of us say it twice. Once after Rebbe Zivoyz Rebbe Shalom, and once right before we step back the three steps. According to the Minhag, you shouldn't do that. Because once he said it, Shmoneh Esrei is over. And he says, in fact, on Shabbos, he says, if you said you were Rotzon, Yetra, and Rotzon, Yetra, and Rotzon, you can't say L'Kai Netzor. Because L'Kai Netzor is a tefillah, personal tefillah, so you're asking for personal things, which you don't do on Shabbos. So when it's part of the Nusach HaTefillah, you're allowed to say it. But if it's not part of the Nusach HaTefillah, you can't. He says, if you said you were Rotzon, it's no longer part of the Nusach HaTefillah, and therefore you can't say it. Again, we don't pass it that way, but that's what the Goyim says. However, when it comes to the Chazan saying it, it is our minhag that if he does say it, he says it silently. There's a whole question whether he has to say Yivu L'Rotzon altogether. Because Yivu L'Rotzon is a request that our tefillah be accepted. And the Chazan says it's Chavel Tzatzon, he's saying that same request that the Kaddish Shalom. So in any event, but it is said, now again, here we run into problems with those who are educated in Yeshiva Tzatzon. Because we go Shabbat Shalom, with Makbid, that it be said and it be said out loud. So that's fine. My daven there, I say it out loud. I never daven from Rambam there, so I never remember from Rambam. But if I were to daven from Rambam, I would say it out loud, because that's the Minhag HaMakom there. On the other hand, the same token, those who daven here should not say it out loud, say it silently. Another question, also a difference in the dog between here and there. when we get to Modi, the Chazan says Modi Menachem Rav. Now, since the Kohol is saying it also, there's some question about not being able to hear the Chazan saying it, and therefore some have the meaning that they wait for the Kohol to get into it and then say it. That is nobody's meaning. Rabbi Yoshi Beres said, say the words Modi Machloch and then wait. Because if everyone is saying Modi and you don't, it looks like you're not Modi. And therefore those words must be said together. But according to him, wait and then say it over again. Nonetheless, the halacha says that the Kohol says it Im HaChazan, with the Chazan. And that's our meaning. So the Chazan should say everything out loud. Once upon a time, the Chazan would say Modi and then keep quiet until Atov Kilochor Rachadav. He said, he mumbled to himself and then say it out loud. That's wrong. He should say every word out loud. But he doesn't have to wait for the Kohol to finish their Modi before he says it. Another one comes up. When it comes to the Aseret Yemei, we add the four lines. So it's a custom for the Kohol to say it before the Chazan says it. That's only for the last two, Chsov and the Sefer. Not Zochreinu and not Michamocha. Zochreinu not because it's a Shem Shemayim in there. Mancha Elokim Chayim. And Michamocha is not a praise. It's not a tefillah, it's a praise. And that was the custom. How it became, and again, there are other in Hogan which say it all loud. How it became the custom, I have a theory. That is because the Rabbanim were down in Losh Manesra and they hadn't finished Manesra when the Chazan got to Zochreinu and Michamocha. The Kohol said it, he wasn't here to tell him to stop, it was in the middle of battle. But that is our meaning. The Kohol does not say the Chazan does. Payet. Dare I say the word? Again, in Mita, for instance, in one sitting, it was universal. Payet was said even more than we do. Because, for instance, on the Rabba Parshios and on Yom Tovim, there's a big one that comes. After we say the Chel Chos Al Ketusha, there's a big one that comes, and we don't say that at all, except on Shabbos Hagadol, where that big one is Hilchos Pesach. But other than that, we don't say it at all. As a consequence of our not saying it, we don't follow what it says in the Marzer. That big one ends up, with, in essence, a paraphrase of the Kadesh Hashimcha. And therefore, since we finish up with that, we start Kasuli Anuviyach. What we say is, we will do Mekadesh as it is written. We who don't say that have to start Mekadesh. So on all those special Shabbosim, we should start Mekadesh. The Vilna Gaon said not to say Payet because he thought it was a Hefsek in the Hazaras Hashatz. But he didn't say don't say Payet, not say Payet. He said say it. Right after Kadesh Tiskago, say Payet. And in the Shulai Davin, which is called Besach Neses Agorah, as I mentioned, that's what they do. After the Chazan says Tiskado, everyone sits down and says everything, and they say the long one too. For Musaf, though, where it's tied into the individual brachas, there he says not to say it. However, I'm going to say it, and we also say Narabis, the pirate that said to Marav on Yontif. And there are halachas too. And besides the fact that you'll find several places you try to bring up rise to halacha from what we say in Payet, which means that they said Payet. It wasn't just something from the relative point. In fact, they said it when it was still a relatively new thing. It was supposed to be Piyutim. The earliest date for the Piyutim was somewhere in the possibly as early as the 5th or 6th century. Someone said it was Rakhali was a Tana. The accepted opinion is though that it was more 8th or 9th century, as was Yanai. The early Paitani. So until that time, nobody said Paitani. You can be sure, because there was no Paitani to be said. But since that time, it is said. I never understood the Vilna Gaon Shita because I'm Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. Even he says to say Paitani. And if it's a Hefsek, why is it not a Hefsek on Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur? And I have yet to hear, I'm sure there's a Teretz for it, and he knew what he was doing. I don't know it. So for Marlovis, the din is that you don't say it Friday night. Some of the shuls here in town, they try to say, you don't say Payet on Shabbos, you don't say Payet on Shabbos. It was only the night. Because at night, the shuls were not well lit, and there was a fear that somebody might bend the candle to see it better, because he's not familiar with the words, and therefore you don't say it Friday night. When the first night is Friday, the din says, Friday night, so you skip it, And then on the second night, you say the pite of the first night. However, it's not that simple either. That can apply. It can't apply to the first day of Pesach, because the first day of Pesach will never be. It can apply to the first day of Pesach. But the din doesn't apply for another reason. The first night of Pesach can be considered to be Friday night, what happened this year. But the second night's pyet is geared to the Omer, to the bringing of the Omer, which was done that night. That's the night they cut it and prepared it. And therefore, since it's connected to that day, that is the day in which it should be said. So that one is the Omer. The second day, the seventh day is Shabbos, which can happen when Shabbos is Erev Pesach. Then on the eighth night, you say the seventh night. Shavuos can never be Friday night, can never be Shabbos Sunday. Just can't happen, calendrically. So that doesn't apply. First night of Sukkot also cannot be, it can be a Shabbos. And then on the second night of Sukkot, you say the first night. The next week, since most of us don't say Piyutim on Sukkot there, so it's not going to apply, you'll skip Friday nights. You're not going to say it's a Shabbos because it's Shabbos is Sukkot there. So it has limited applicability. And there is, now, as far as, once upon a time, they used to say the Piyutim of Birkas Krishna also, which are the true Yotzros. All the Piyutim have names. The ones you say in Shema are called Yotzros, because it's said in Yotzerah. The only thing we say now, if we say Piyutim, are the Brach Dodis and Yom Le'Avosha of Pesach. Other than that, we don't say. If anybody is tired, please feel free. I will not be offended if you feel me to leave. Now, Hashanahs. There are two customs. One is to say Hashanahs right after Shacharis, and the other one is to say it after Musaf. The advantage of saying it right after Shacharis is you have a little blessing in your hand already, because you just said Hallel. However, Aramaic needs to do it after Musaf. The idea being to have a little blessing for Shacharis, and again to have it for Musaf. To have it in both, Dafka, in particular, to have it in both teams, not to put them together. And that is the meaning. Somehow or other, there is a struggle. Again, everybody does it after Shacharis, but they say that they got it from the Sfarad. There are many Minhagim in Eretz Yisrael of the Ashkenazim that were taken from the Sfarad and from the Gun. And the Gun thought, Mishin Tei Baruch Hashem Olam Amen V'Amen Amayim. So that was taken from the Sfarad. But saying Vidui on Monday and Thursday was taken from the Sfarad. Ashkenazim did not say Vidui before the Rav. There are a couple of other such examples. Saying Sim Shalom Shabbos to Vidui is not the meaning of Rav. The Rav said Shalom Rav. But again, that's because the idea, we say Sim Shalom to Mincha in the fast. And the reason is because in the fast to Mincha, the Kohanim can do it. And in the Duchen, it says Yor Hashem Pana Lelacha. And here we say Kibor Panecha in Sim Shalom. So that's why we say Sim Shalom. According to this, when the Sfaradim say it, and the Sfaradim, basically the Sfaradim say it, every day they say Sim Shalom. Many of them to Muslim, Marib also doesn't say Shalom at all. But even the Yusuf Sfarad, which does say, well, again, they say Sim Shalom all the time. But as far as Shabbat, we don't. But for some say that on Shabbos to Mincha, since you're laying, now the Tonus, you can't fast, you can't do it to Mincha. The Tonus, you don't do it to Mincha, because the Tonus may have eaten. The Tonus, you don't eat, so you can fast, and therefore you can do it, and therefore you say Baruch Adonai, and say Sim Shalom. Some say it's, the others want to say it's not because of the Eskohani, it's because of Kriyas HaTorah. The difference is Shabbos. Shabbos to Mincha, you can't do it, but you're too late. And therefore they say Sim Shalom. But again, that was taken from those, it was not Nusaf Ashkenaz. The original Nusaf Ashkenaz said Shalom Rav, including the very good on Shabbos to Mincha. How to clap a Shabbos? That's a deep truth. It is not their Acher, it's to bang the Shabbos when their Kodesh is open. And therefore, our meaning is, you say the whole piyut up until the words called Vasa Vasa Goyner. Stop, have the Sefer Torah put back into their Kodesh, the Chazan says the Skabel, and then gently, five times and no more, one touches the ground with the shiner, and three times, while hitting it five times, he says three times, called the Vasa, the Vasa. Stripping the Arava is Minig Yilavi. When we bench Rosh Chodesh, and it's 2 days of Rosh Chodesh, so you'll hear Rosh Chodesh so-and-so yed b'yom shlishi ul-machraso b'yom revi. What's the machraso for? Don't we know that Wednesday comes after Tuesday? Of course, you're not supposed to say. The only time you're supposed to say it is in Rosh Chodesh, Shabbos, and Sunday. Because if you say Rosh Chodesh, Rosh Chodesh so-and-so yed b'yom Shabbos Chodesh, u'v'yom rishon, somebody might think it's tomorrow. But it's not, you mean a week from tomorrow. So therefore, you say it's Shabbos, ul-machraso b'yom rishon, the Sunday that comes after that Shabbos. But when it's Tuesday, Wednesday, there's no purpose to say the machraso at all. Saying Avarachmi during Sfira. The Avarachmi that we say every Shabbos was said because of the events that took place during, not really Kibbutz, but the Kihilas that were during the Sfira days. And customs vary greatly that way. Some say it every Shabbos between Pesach and Shavuos. Our meaning is that so long as it's Chodesh Nisan and we haven't begun the prohibitions of Sfira, we don't say it. And all year we say it, but in Sivan, it's again, it's either Rosh Chodesh, well, Rosh Chodesh Sivan will never have a chance. It's either Yom HaMilchas, the second day of the month, which is called Yom HaMilchas, because it comes between 2 years of the days, between Rosh Chodesh and Rosh Chodesh and Agbola. It has no Yichas of its own, so it's called Yom HaMilchas. It's Lashon Sagi Nahar. And if it comes out, as it does this year, on Erev Pesach Shavuos, or if it comes out 2 days before Shavuos, it's again the year when Shabbos is Erev Pesach, then Dalet Sivan can be Shabbos. In those days, we don't say the year. So the only time we say up, we don't. We do not. The only time we say after Rachim on Shabbos Mevorchim is Shabbos Mevorchim Sivan. That's Shabbos we say. Now in Eretz Yisrael again, they have a minute to say it. It's a the luchas to say it on Mevorchim Ov also. Ov in the 3 weeks we'll be saying we mentioned Shmei Yishav. They fly down and they say it. Of course, since I'm in the shul, I say it with them. Without the Yehidus, I wouldn't. As far as not saying Tachnun after Shavuos, and saying Tachnun after the Yomim Tovim. So the Din says that not to say Tachnun between Yom Kippur and Sukkot. And of course not to say Tachnun all the month of Nisan, and not to say Tachnun from Rosh Chodesh Sivan until Yisro Chag, inclusive. But we expand it. Not just we in the community, in many communities. And that is that in Tishrei, we don't say it from after Yom Kippur until after Rosh Chodesh Cheshvan. We don't say it the whole rest of Kislev of Tishrei, even though we should. And in Shavuos, the Pesach and Sukkot, one of the 7-day Yontif, one of the 8-day Yontif, the korbanos that a person is supposed to bring on Yontif, the Aras Riyah and the Chagiga, should be brought ideally on the first day of Yontif. Unless it's Shabbos. But there's Yesham Tashlumin called Shiva. You have 7 days to make it good. On Shavuos, you only have the 1 day of Yom Kippur. But there the din too is that if you didn't bring the korban on the first day, you have the next 6 days to bring it. And therefore, does that minig? Let it follow the pattern of Pesach and Shavuos and Sukkot. We don't say Tachnun on Shavuos and the 6 days thereafter, which means that all of next week we will not say Tachnun, including not saying Tzikos for Tzedek on a week from the Shabbos, then Sunday morning we'll start saying Tachnun. There is machlokes whether or not to say Kiskaba in an Ovel's house, our minhag is to say it. There's some have the meaning that instead of saying Lamatzeach in the Ovel's house, on a day you don't say Tachnun, you say a different parak, instead Mirtam the Dov. Our minhag is to say Lamatzeach on all occasions. Okay. That's now, as far as the Kriyas HaTorah is concerned, and I'll finish with a couple of brief notes about that. In addition to the rules that we have about the three psukim, there's another thing too. A stop should be at a good point. Don't stop at something which is not so pleasant. And this gives rise to two places where the general meaning is what's printed in the Chumashim is not what we do. Actually, there are three, but one is pretty much universal. The universal one is Dvarim. Where Sheni is marked off, the next pasuk starts, Echo Esau Badi, Torachem Asachem Rechem. Which not only is not such a good thing, but also has echoes of the Echo of the 9 days. And therefore, although we lay until that point during the week, because we're not going to say the next pasuk, on Shabbos we stop the pasuk before Sheni. So we don't begin the next Aliyah with Echo. There are two places, though, where it is marked, and we don't do it, because actually there's a dispute as to the meanings of the words themselves. One is in Bereishis, where there's a stop, a pasuk which says, Os Huchal Likro B'Shem Hashem. Now, Huchal means they began. Huchal can also mean profaned. And the Bedrash says indeed that means that they started worshiping Avodah Zarah. And therefore, although it's marked as a stop, we don't stop there. Instead, we keep on going, and there's a pasuk a few pages later, Vachos Tu Valkayi Nama, we make a stop there. The other one is in Vayigash, where when Yaakov comes to Mitzrayim, when Parakos comes, the Ichlu Lechelet Oretz, and eat from the fat of the land. And where I'm meaning is not to stop there. Because eating from the fat of the land in Golos can be a non-bracha. You can forget that you're in Golos. And Vayishman Yishurim Vayivot. And therefore, we don't stop there. And instead, we find a stop a little later on to do it. There's another place where you don't stop where the Chumashim say to stop. That's where he mentioned in Halacha, according to one opinion. And that is Maseh. And this only applies in the years when Matos and Maseh are separated. Because the stop is Vayachmu B'Yamsuf. Now, what happens there is there are 42 journeys that the Jews made when they left Mitzrayim. This is right at the beginning, after the first three or four. And there's an opinion that says, Ein mafsikim b'masos. Don't interrupt the meeting. The reason is Alpi Kabbalah. Because the 42 masos are a remnant to the Shem Shal Mem Beis. There's one of the Shem Shal Mem Beis, 42 letters. So you don't want to chop off the name in the middle. And therefore, it applies only if you're going to be doing all of it. On Monday and Thursday, it does not apply. Although there are some places in Israel where they go through all the masos on Shabbos to Mincha and Monday and Thursday. We don't. But on Shabbos, we do. Which means we keep on going into where Shlishi is marked. And then we make another stop between Shlishi and Rabbi, so we don't interrupt any of ourselves.
Hazinu?
What?
Hazinu?
Hazinu, the stops are given. That is my choice, what they mean. But there's a simon Hazayu Loch. The first one is Hazinu, the second one is Chorim Vesolam, Yaki Leo Mabas Eores, Kiesosh Magnot, Nakhot. The love is the Yinot, and Luchot Yaskiluzos, and Kiesosh Magnot. So there, you can't make a service. I used to worship on our builders, because when they had a symphony, they gave everybody of these, 20 of these, 30 of these. The greatest idea when there was enough, when they had a symphony on Parshas Nasa, where you can make 50 of these. I wish them a symphony on Parshas Nasa, because in Parshas Nasa, you can make one of yourself, you can stop and after, but that's it. Vayelech is the same way. The only way to make a symphony Vayelech is by moving where Shmi is, that move enough pasuk should be, enough sukkim, moving down a pasuk should be, enough sukkim. So that's, but I'm saying that the other, so those are the ones where there's a difference between what's printed in the Sukkim and what's written in what we do. Okay, basically, I think that's clear. Oh, another question. And that is, when we lay in the Megillus. First of all, the question, do we lay in the Megillus together or not? The Megillus. Shir and Rus and Kohelis. The Sephardim don't. Many Hasidim don't. On the other hand, according to the Sefer Sofri, you lay in it from a cloth with two brachas, Amikra Megillah and Shefiyana. Except Echa, you don't make a Shefiyana. Amikra Megillah, yes, Shefiyana, not. Our meaning is to lay in the Megillus. We're not be done a cloth, but even when we do read from a cloth, we do not lay the bracha.
Why?
Because, and not according to some reason, I'm supposed to lay it all together. And so, I mean, the chumrah we need it, but some brachas are not there, we don't lay the bracha. That's right, not two brachas. Okay. Cover everything. Yeah. One thing that bothers me is when they say Yamdu Amad Biyadagoda. Yamod is reserved for a person who's coming up to an Aliyah. And you don't say Yamdu Amad Biyadagoda. You say Misha Berach, Salam, who you work is plenty, but plenty Babu Shialu Akbar Satar. Besides, if you're going to do it, then you should say Yamod plenty, but plenty Hakka. Because how do you know who my brother goes? Because you told him. So you told me so, but he should come as soon as he's told. So that's not said. Okay, there are a few other minor ones, but now it's after 10 o'clock and everything. Even though it's not a minhag muffin, it should be a minhag muffin. Most people should go after 10 o'clock.
Not even on Kash Omer. The Rav always told me that there's a minhag here to only say Kaddish and the Rabbana and the Kaddish and Agadita. I was corrected. I was told very specifically.
Without
a Kaddish. No, without a Kaddish. But say it.